want to be succinct in our presentation today, so we need your prayers. Genesis chapter 14, I'm going to read from the New Living Translation, verses 14 through 16. When you get an opportunity, read all of chapter 14 and 15, for it does make up the background and the context of what we're going to be talking about today. Genesis chapter 14, verses 14 through 16. If you're there already, and you should be, say amen.
Amen.
Amen. This is what the word says. When Abram heard that his nephew Lot had been captured, he mobilized the 318 trained men who had been born into his household. Then he pursued Kedorlaomer's army until he caught up with them at Dan. There he divided his men and attacked during the night. Kedorlaomer's army fled, but Abram chased them as far as Hobah, north of Damascus. Verse 16 says, Abram recovered all the goods that had been taken, and he brought back his nephew Lot with his possessions and all the women and other captives. And so I want to talk to you from the subject, when God gives the victory. When God gives the victory. When God gives the victory. Let us pray. Father God, in the name of Jesus, we come and humbly before you to thank you. Thank you for this expression of your love, this privilege, this opportunity, this blessing of worship. Grateful for all that we have already experienced in the worship setting. What our eyes have seen, our ears have heard, and our hearts have felt. We are truly grateful. And now, Lord, as we worship in the word, we pray that you would take us to another level in our experience today, and that you would use us to speak into the hearts of your people. We pray, oh God, that your word would come through, that your message would come through, and not my preconceived agenda. Bless that all that we do in worship would be acceptable to you. Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of all of our hearts be acceptable in your sight. For Lord, you are strength and our Redeemer. In Jesus' name we pray. And every heart say amen.
Amen.
When God gives the victory. In the book of Genesis, we are introduced to Abram. And here he is Abram. But for those of us who have read the Bible, know the Bible to some degree, understand that his name will be changed. God is going to change his name and has changed his name to Abraham.
Amen.
And he is the father of the faithful. He is also known as the progenitor of both Judaism and Christianity. And he is known for his faith. Is there a Bible reader in the house? If you read through the timeline of Abraham's life and his experiences, you will see him, in spite of the challenges of his life, in spite of the difficulties that he faced, you will see him going from victory to victory, from blessings to blessings in his relationship with the Lord. And I believe you also find that Abraham's victories were closely tied to his faith in God.
Amen.
Amen. Abraham had faith, and it wasn't just the kind of faith that shows up for an hour and a half on Sundays. Abraham had faith for every corridor of his life. Abraham had faith. He had faith for his family. He had faith for his finances. He had faith for his children. He had faith for his physical health, and he had faith for his spiritual well-being. Abraham had faith, and Abraham didn't have faith in just anything or anybody. Abraham connected his faith with the one true and living God. In spite of the fact that he existed in the time of a predominantly polytheistic society, where people put their faith in many small g gods, Abraham connected to the one true and living God. Abraham put his faith in Yahweh. Abraham put his faith in Jehovah. Abraham put his faith in Elohim. I know that the reason he had so many victories in his life is because Abraham put his confidence in God. And if all I'm experiencing is defeat in my life, one defeat after another defeat, I need to check where I have placed my confidence, where I have anchored my faith. I may need to check and make sure that I have my confidence in the right God. Because if your faith is in the big G God, as opposed to all these little G's, you are guaranteed to get the victory in your life. Are y'all gonna pray with me? And I want to look at that against the backdrop of Genesis chapter 14. And what we find in there is that war broke out. You see that in verse 1 in chapter 14, the Bible says that war broke out. And by now, Abraham is a multi-millionaire. God has already blessed him. He's a multi-millionaire. God has prospered him. And the Bible says that God, if you read the timeline of his experiences, you'll see that God has been shaping Abraham's faith through his experiences. And he's been blessing him as time has gone on. And suddenly the Bible says war breaks out. And there are five kings who form an alliance. Amen. And then they get together with five kings, five armies, and they go to war with four kings and their armies. And the four kings defeat the five kings. Amen. You'll get all this when you read the whole chapter. The four defeat the five. And when they defeated them, they begin to take their people into bondage. They begin to take their resources as booty. Not baby got back booty, but booty in meaning their resources, their finances. I know that's what you were thinking about. And you need to understand that they took this booty, these resources, and these finances into captivity. Amen. And the word got back to Abram because along with this booty, they took the people. They took the women and they took the children and they took the men and they put them in bondage. Are y'all praying with me? I'm preaching out the Bible. And the Bible says that along with all of these resources and people that they captured, the Bible says that Abram's nephew Lot was included in those who were placed in bondage and in captivity. And Abraham, because of his faith in God, began to work in response to this challenge, this crisis that came into the life of his family. It came into his family's life. And y'all know that Lot, those of you who are Bible readers know that Lot was living among the Sodomites. He was living in Sodom. And so when the four overcame the five, they took Lot and Sodom into captivity. And the Bible says that Abraham, because of his faith in God, took 318 trained men. And he took those 318 trained men. And he did something with those 318 trained men that five kings and five armies couldn't do together. Are y'all praying with me? Yeah, the Bible says he went out, chased down the captives, defeated them, got his nephew out of bondage, got the people of Sodom out of bondage, and got all their resources out of captivity. Watch what faith does. Faith, this is what faith does. It got his nephew out of bondage. Because family is worth fighting for. Not just his family, but it got the whole community out of bondage and delivered them. Because faith is not satisfied with just your family. You get that on the way home. Faith is not satisfied with just you. Faith wants the whole community. Amen. Faith is not happy with just your household. He wants your neighbors. I wish I had a witness in here. And the Bible says that he helped to deliver the entire community. Abraham, this is how faith responds to the victory that Abraham got. The Bible talks about the fact that after he got the victory, after he overcame the five kings with 318 trained men, after he got his nephew Lot back, after he got the community of Sodom back, after he got all of their resources and all their finances and all of the booty back, the Bible says that Abraham responds to the victory that God brings into his experience. Are y'all gonna pray with me? Yeah. And I love that because we need to know that there is a proper response to the victory that God gives us. Whenever God brings victory in your experience, I don't care how big or how small it is, there ought to be some celebration. I wish I had a witness in here. There ought to be some celebration. And I studied in school what's called that the psychology of celebration. That whenever there is an achievement that is made, whenever there is an accomplishment made, whenever there is a victory won, you need to pause for a moment and celebrate it. You need to take a break from the toils and the struggle and celebrate the victory. Amen. That's the psychology of celebration. And there is proper celebration, and then there is improper celebration. When God brings a victory, there is good celebration and then bad celebration. Are y'all gonna pray with me? Yeah. You need to understand about the psychology of celebration. When God gives you victory, when you graduate, you need to pause from studying and note taking and writing papers and celebrating. When you get married, amen, you need to pause from running around and clubbing. Come on, somebody. Get together with your mate and celebrate. When the Lord bless you with a baby, or a grandbaby, or a great-grandbaby, you need to pause, and that's the psychology of celebration, and celebrate. You need to recognize the moment and appreciate the moment that God has brought into your experience. And my question is, when you get the victory, when God brings victory into your life, how do you celebrate? Amen. Because there's good and bad celebration. Amen. Do you celebrate at the club with your friends? When you make an achievement, come on, somebody. Do you go to the club and get high when you celebrate? Or do you go to the bar and get drunk when you celebrate? Do you step out and say, amen, I made this achievement, I owe myself, and so I'm going to do whatever I want to do. Are y'all going to pray with me? There's good and... Oh, y'all ain't hear me like that. 2 weeks ago, the New York Football Giants... Sorry, no. New York Football Giants beat the Washington Redskins. And it wasn't just any kind of game, any kind of victory. What happened was the Redskins got kicked out of the playoffs. And the Giants went into the playoffs.
No celebration.
Oh, just a bunch of Cowboys fans. I don't care about nobody. Bunch of Cowboys. All right. But the Giants won the game, and they went to the playoffs. They made the playoffs, and the Redskins got kicked out of the playoffs.
All right.
So what happened was, some of the players, Odell Beckham Jr., and Victor Cruz and others, celebrated the victory. And what they did was they flew from New York City to Miami. And when they got to Miami, they went to the club and they celebrated. They parked. Come on, somebody. Then they rented the yacht and they went on the ocean. Come on. And celebrated. And like we do, we can't keep nothing to ourselves. We gotta put everything on social media. And they celebrated. And what happened was a lot of people say, nah, that's going too far with the celebration because it's too much because you haven't made it yet to the Super Bowl. You got the playoffs next week. All the football players, all the non-football fans went to sleep. So what happened was they were criticizing them for going, for celebrating in the wrong way. I don't know, it ain't up to me. These are professionals, they get paid a lot of money. If they have, you had a lot of discretionary money, you'd be in Miami today too. Y'all know I won't say amen. You know the storm is coming. You won't be here either. Amen? I ain't blaming them for wanting to be in Miami in January. God bless you. But what happened was that when it came time for the next game, those folks who were normally productive people, like Odell Beckham, missing passes, this is a brother who can catch the ball with one hand, couldn't catch it with two hands. I was there. And so maybe what the critics were saying was right, that sometimes we can go overboard with the celebration when we don't celebrate the right way. Are y'all gonna pray with me? Well, Abram gives us a different picture because Abram doesn't go to the nightclub when he got to the victory. He didn't get a drink to get his drink on when he got to victory. He didn't go running around with somebody else's wife because he felt like he owed himself when he got to victory. I wish I had a witness. Abram does something totally different, which boggles my mind, but it helps us to understand what to do in response when God gives us the victory. Well, hurry up, preacher. You know the storm is coming. Tell us what Abram did when he got the victory. Well, first of all, the Bible says in verses 18 and 19 that Abraham has a connection with Melchizedek. Melchizedek, for Bible readers, you know that Melchizedek is a priest, a prophet, and a king. And the Bible says that he comes out of nowhere and he connects with Abram after the victory. And the scripture says that he brings something to the meeting. The Bible says Melchizedek brings bread and wine. Because it was a time to celebrate the blessings and the victory that God brought into Abram's experience. And for many of us know already, because you read the Bible and you read it through, that Melchizedek is a type of Christ.
Right.
Now please don't go and say, I say that Melchizedek is Christ.
Right.
I said he is a type of Christ.
Right.
Amen. Because I don't want you to confuse that, because the Bible in the Old Testament is a foreshadowing of the substance of the New Testament.
Right.
And so this is a foreshadowing of Christ. It's not Christ. At least I can't say it's Christ, but I know he's a foreshadowing of Christ. He is a picture of Christ. Now sometimes we can get confused, and I was told by my son-in-law, he said that the grandmother Oprah was talking to her about babies being born. And he was talking to her that mama was going to be with Sister King as she was delivering her baby. And Oprah asked him, is she going to deliver baby Jesus? They said, baby Jesus, baby. That's all she knows, baby Jesus. Baby Jesus, baby Jesus. And so everybody having a baby, she's wondering if it's baby Jesus coming. I told her, well, tell her, no, Jesus came already. And he came as a baby the last time. But this time, he's coming as the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. I wish I had a witness in here. Melchizedek, being a type of Christ, like Christ, he has no beginning, even though he did stop off in a little town called Bethlehem. He is from everlasting to everlasting. He has no beginning and he has no ending. I wish I had a witness in here. He is a picture of Christ. And like a picture of Christ, he is a priest, he is a prophet, and he is a king. And so when Abram got the victory from God and he connected with Melchizedek, look what Melchizedek does. He brings bread and wine. Because after your victory, you need some bread and wine. But don't get me wrong, I ain't talking about boom farm. I ain't talking, come on, I wish I had a ribbon. Or Thunderbird. I ain't talking about that. Bread and wine here represents something else. The bread represents the word of God. Because when you connect with the priest, with the pastor, I wish I had a witness. He ought to have some bread and wine to help you to form your theology as you celebrate. Bread. Bread meaning the word of God. And you need the word of God. Because the word of God will help to shape your theology so you can fix your celebration. And you have the right response to God's victory. It's there in the text. And wine represents celebration. And we need bread, we need the word, and we need celebration. I wish I had a witness in here. When you connect with your preacher, pastor, with your prophet, he needs to bring some bread, some word, and some celebration. There needs to be some balance. If I got up here and just read the word and just explained the word, and I didn't bring any celebration with it, that is only half a meal. You need the bread, you need the word to help you to know how to celebrate and what you're celebrating. What is he celebrating, Pastor? Well, what did Melchizedek tell him? He says that you need to know that I'm a priest of the Most High God. That's what we need to celebrate, that he is the Most High God. And if he is the Most High God, there is nothing higher than him. And if he is your God, there's nothing higher than your God. Oh, y'all didn't get me. I was studying, and then I learned this in school about Hebrew. When the language Hebrew, their superlatives are different than ours. When we want to say something is the best, we say it's the greatest. We say it is the holiest. It is the biggest. But in Hebrew, they don't use superlatives like that. And in the old Hebrew, they use repetition to indicate superlatives. You don't get that on the way home. They use superlatives. What do you mean? Well, instead of saying that he is the king, he's the Hebrew will say he is king of kings. Instead of saying that he is the holiest, it says holy of holy.
Yes, sir.
So what Melchizedek says when he says the Most High God, he is God of gods.
Right.
He is the big G over the little G.
Yes, sir.
He is the highest. He is the greatest. He is the holiest. He is the strongest. He is all of those things. And so what you need to know is when he says he's the Most High God, he's higher than any of your enemies. He's higher than any of your diseases. He's higher than any of your problems. Whatever you need to be him to be, he is big enough to be that for you. Hurry up, preacher, because you know the storm is coming. He says, look, he gives him a three-point message. He says he is the Most High God. Not only is he the Most High God, he is the creator of the heavens and earth. He is the creator of all things. And if God is the creator, creator of all things, that means that God is able to provide all things. And you know, the Bible says that when God created the heavens and earth, he came a step out of the void. He stepped out of nothing, and he called on something to make something else. He called on nothing to make something. So God can take nothing and make, oh, somebody ought to say amen. Somebody will say, I'm going to say hallelujah. If God can take nothing and make it into something, then whatever you need, God can make a way out of no way. I got to hurry up. I got to hurry up. He says he's the most high God. Not only is he the most high God, he is the creator of the heavens and earth. Then he says something else, and that blew my mind. He said that he is the one who gives you the victory over your enemy. Oh, you missed the shout, right? He is the one who gave you the victory over your enemies. And he, what Melchizedek came to do in bringing bread and celebration, bringing word and celebration, he was working to shape Abram's theology so that he understood where the victory came from, so that he might be able to understand how to respond to the victory. And the Bible says that once he got his theology straight, then he was able to see the reality of generosity. Because the scripture, and I ain't making this up, the scripture says in verse 20 that Abraham, after he met with the preacher told him, gave him a three-point sermon. God is the most high God. God is the creator of heaven and earth. God is the one who gives you the victory. That's three points. All right? And the scripture says that after he received that message, that after that, he understood the reality of generosity. The Bible says in verse 20 that he gave a tithe from all that he had. Don't y'all let me lose you. We're on the way home. He gave it after he understood, after he met with the preacher, that he understood the word of God, and he understood how to celebrate. The Bible says that he does something strange. He makes an offering, a tithe, out of all that he received. Abraham gave a tithe of everything. And I love this because the preacher wasn't even talking about tithe. That wasn't even an offertory appeal. Nobody said, it's time to give. Deacons didn't show up with baskets. I wish I had a word. There was no capital campaign. There was no stewardship campaign. There was no mortgage to pay. But the Bible says that after he got his theology together, he understood the generosity of God, and he turned around and was generous back to God by giving him a tithe over all that he had. Are y'all going to pray with me? He got the right theology, and when you get the right theology, it leads to our generosity. If you can't believe what the Bible says, I can't help you. Nothing I can do for you. I was talking to a brother, and we were talking, discussing the word, and I was trying to witness to him, and I found out later in the conversation that he didn't believe the Bible. He said, here you go with Paul again. There you go with Paul, the Apostle Paul. I don't believe what Paul had. I said, well, we are wasting time. I'm wasting your time, and you wasting my time. Because if you don't believe what the Bible says, that this is the word of God, that it is the truth over all other truths, I can't help you. Because if God can't help you and Paul can't help you, I still can't help you. After he got his theology straight, he believed the word of God as it was given to him. The scripture says that he gave a tithe. Now, after he started tithing, and some of us can attest to this, that's when the test came. Verse 21 says, after he gave a tithe over all that he had, then the king of Sodom came.
That's right. Come on.
Yes, sir.
We're almost done, but I need your amen so we can move on. The Bible says that after he started tithing, he was tested by King of Sodom. King of Sodom said, listen, King of Sodom said, look, You can have all of the resources, all of our stuff. Just give me back the people. Y'all see that in your Bible? He said, if you give me back the people, you can have all of the stuff that you want. Keep it for yourself. And then that's the test. And somebody said, why is that a test? I said the same thing when I read it as a child. When I read it as a child, I said, well, what's wrong with that? What's wrong with taking some of the spoils of war? You were the one who delivered folk. You were the one who set captives free. You were the one who were a blessing to the people of Sodom and a blessing to your nephew Lot. What would be wrong with taking a reward from the king of Sodom? But then as I grew up in the word of God, I understood the response that Abram gave to the king of Sodom. Look, I don't want nothing from you. Our God, my God, is the most high God. My God is the creator of the heavens and earth. I don't need anything from you. Because my God has it all. Y'all gonna give me a minute. And y'all didn't hear my mama when she said, you can't start off with wrong and end up right. Because there's always going to be some folk who will try to tell you, don't you listen to that priest. Don't you listen to that preacher. Don't you listen to that pastor. And don't take all of that. You can do it this way. I got a shortcut to get you what you want and to get you where you want to be. But you need to know. Something wrong with it. And my mama said, you can't start off with wrong and end up right. I know you were listening when Luther Ingram said, if loving you is wrong, I don't want to be right. Am I wrong to fall so deeply in love with you? Yeah. Because you got a wife and two little children depending on you two. Are you wrong to give your heart to a married man? Yes, you are, baby. Because if you look in your Bible, you only remember 2 points. I know y'all remember the whole sermon every time. He only remembered 2 points. He said, my God is the most high God. My God is the creator of the heavens and the earth, of all things. Y'all with me? He didn't remember the third one. But I got to give it to Abel. At least he got two. He doesn't have the Bible we had, social media we had. He doesn't have all of the Sunday school we had, all the adult Bible study opportunities we had. He didn't remember all that. He only got two. And it's kind of like when I was growing up as a kid and I was in school. And you know, every once in a while, the teacher would say, this is going to be a test. But it's an open book test.
All right. All right.
It's open book. And I never sweated open. I ain't hard to study when they say the open book test. Because all I did was open the book. Because all of the questions and all of the answers are found in one book.
Yes, sir.
And so I ain't tripped about the test. All I did was, and I always got A's on open book tests. I just opened the book. But we ain't talking about your textbook. We're talking about the Lord's book. And you are tested on a daily basis. And you got all of the answers to the test before the test gets here. All you got to do is open the book. He got his theology together. And when he got his theology together, he understood the reality of time. And what I need to understand, what help me to understand why people won't give the way they ought to give is because they're not familiar with the book. If you get familiar with the book, tithing is not a problem. Last thing, I know I got a lot there, but I got to move on. the last thing is the scripture says that he gets the right theology. Once he gets the right theology, he understands the reality of tithing, and he gives back to God 10%, which represents the whole that God has given him. And it was it's a token that God has blessed you, that you realize that the blessings came from God in the first place. If I had hours to preach, I'd stay there, but I need to finish this up so you can get home safely. The last thing, after he got his theology right, after he got understood the reality of tithing, the Bible says that there was repeated triumph. And if you notice, there is a circle here, there is a cycle, that he triumphed because of God over his enemies, and he delivered Lot, his family, and he delivered his finances, and he delivered the community, and delivered the resources. After he did that, the Bible says that he got his theology together with Melchizedek. Once he got the theology together, he understood the generosity of giving back to God. I wish I had a witness in this place. After that, the Bible says there that he got that together, and he began to tithe, he got another triumph. He said, where's that preacher? 15, chapter 15, verse 1. Sometime later, the Lord spoke to Abram in a vision and said to him, do not be afraid, Abram, for I will protect you and your reward will be great. Now he started this thing with a reward, with a triumph. He started this thing with a victory. He responded by going, getting his theology about right, about who God is and what he has done. He gives a tithe in response. He becomes generous in response to God's ultimate generosity. And then the scripture says he goes right back to another triumph. Because the Bible says God gives him a vision that if you just be faithful, your reward is going to be great. And every time I turn around, I get blessed again. And when I get blessed, I get my theology so I can respond in the right way to God. Once I get that, I get generous and give back to God by serving him and serving his people. Once that happens, then he turns around and blesses me again. Are y'all praying with me? It's not a vicious cycle. It is a visible manifestation of truth in the faith of God. And when you put your faith in God, he will bless you over and over. Over. And remember the time when you didn't have a dime, but the Lord blessed you and gave money into your bank account when you didn't even know it. Do you remember the time before that when you didn't know how you were going to feed your family and you had lost your job out of the blue, out of nowhere? God blessed you with a job so you can bless your children. I wish I had a witness in here. Do you remember when your daddy walked out on you and it was just your mama and your family, but God kept on blessing you and put people in your life to invest in you and to be a blessing? Oh, do you remember the time before that when you were sick and afflicted and the doctor gave you a bad report, but you went to the Lord, turned your face to God, and God healed your body? Do you remember? The Bible said he got another trial. And scripture said, if you read the timeline of Abram's experience, you will note that there is this cycle of his faith being developed. Right. And after the test came, he would pass the test. When he went to Mount Moriah, and the scripture says God told him, give your son as a sacrifice. Yes, the scripture said that Abram was ready to be obedient to God, to kill his own son. And God provided a ram and a mercy. Is there anybody in here who knows that's the kind of God that we serve? Well, you need to understand that there is a psychology of celebration, that when God gives the victory, we need to celebrate the right way. Are y'all praying with me? Yeah. There was a triumph. And then there was a theology awakening. And then there was generosity in his giving. And the scripture says that this cycle kept on repeating itself over and over again. And I look at my own experience. And the Lord brought me through something here lately, the last couple of years. And I had to sit down. And the preachers in the house know what I'm talking about. I had to sit down and I had to outline what the Lord had done and the victories that were won because of him. I had to outline it. I had to write it out. I had to put it on paper. And it was a daunting experience because I had trouble trying to remember what we had accomplished under these 18 years of the Lord's blessing. I had to write it down. And one of the things that happened as I began to write it down, I realized that I didn't do anything. I ain't trying to hurt your feelings, but you didn't do anything. I realized God did everything. I realized that. And as I began to write, tears began to come out of my face because I remembered how the Lord had brought me such a mighty long way. I remembered how I left New Orleans. Come on, somebody. Broke without a dime in my pocket. I remember how I left. God don't hear me like I need you. I remember how I left searching for my own identity because of the voids in my past. But I know that God has taken me from where I started from and lifted me up to be something I never thought I could be. And there might be somebody else in here who understands what I'm talking about. That when folk want you to tell your story and you got to give your testimony, and they say, go on, friend, help us understand where you come from. Well, I need to tell you something. I got to tell you that whatever that has happened in my life that has been good, God did it. I can do it. I can do it in three words. God did it. Continue.